Have you ever heard the phrase, the book of life? I've heard the phrase, but honestly, it is not part of my primary lexicon. Several years ago, I heard that expression from a Jewish coworker. They were leaving the company, and as they said goodbye to me, they said, "May your name be found in the book of life." I received his blessing as a thoughtful and genuine wish. Occasionally, I think of them and whisper a prayer that they recognize Messiah. Let's look at what the Bible says about the book of life. Philippians 4:3. "And I urge you also, true companion, help these women who labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are written in the book of life." Philippians was written by Paul. We get that from Philippians 1:1. "Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus which are at Philippi, with the bishops and deacons." Philippians only has 4 chapters, so this is approaching the conclusion of the letter. Paul is requesting support be provided to certain people who were supports to him. "Help these women who labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and the rest of my fellow workers." Then Paul adds a description that applies to all of these believers, his fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life. The word "are" is in italics because it is an implied word to read as proper English. Evidently, having your name in the book of life is a part of being a worker for Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, chapter 3, Jesus' message is being given to Sardis. "To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of the one who holds the 7 spirits of God and the 7 stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation for being alive, yet you are dead." There seems to be a bit of confusion here. They have a reputation, quote-unquote, of being alive. We don't know who is spreading this gossip, but evidently it is wrong. "Yet you are dead." No, really. "Wake up and strengthen what remains, which was about to die. They are only mostly dead. For I have found your deeds incomplete in the sight of my God. Remember then what you have received and heard. Keep it and repent. If you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know the hour when I come upon you." These are Christians. They have heard the gospel. "If you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know the hour when I will come upon you." Where have I heard this "coming like a thief" motif before? 1 Thessalonians 5:2, "For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." This is speaking of the day of the Lord. Verse 4, "But you, brothers, are not in the darkness, so that this day should overtake you like a thief." 2 Peter 3:10, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief." This is again speaking of the day of the Lord. "And then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed." And then, after, maybe immediately after, the day of the Lord, a whole bunch of very bad things happen. Revelation 16:15, "Behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who remains awake and clothed, so that he will not go naked and let his shame be exposed." This is speaking of his second coming. In some ways, these passages have always given me pause. Does your mind ever recall that the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy? Well, if you ever get confused that maybe Jesus is coming like a thief to steal and kill and destroy, just finish the verse. "I have come that they may have life and have it in all its fullness." Jesus does not come as a thief. He comes like a thief. That means coming by surprise, to catch you unawares, unprepared. Luke 12:39. But understand this, if the homeowner had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You do not know when the thief is coming. Likewise, you do not know when the day of the Lord is coming. We also do not know when Yeshua is coming for his bride. I noticed two phrases are used. The first phrases are around the day of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 5:2, the day of the Lord will come. 5:4, so that this day should overtake you. 2 Peter 3:10, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The second phrase, Revelation 16:15, behold, I am coming like a thief. I found that interesting. Jesus could have said, the day I come will come like a thief, to continue the motif. But must this mean a separate event? Possibly the rapture? Not necessarily. Remember, context, context, context. The context, this is Revelation 16. After the sixth bowl is poured out, right before Armageddon is about to happen. I just could not, in all good conscience, even try to make the case this refers to a rapture that will have likely happened long ago in Revelation 4. I don't know if anyone is trying to use this verse to support a belief in the rapture, but if they did, I'd encourage them to stop. Back to the Book of Life. But you do have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments, and because they are worthy, they will walk with me in white. I don't know why my mind is going down these paths. Perhaps it was my recent mention of being mature and not tossed about by every wind and doctrine. But as I read this, I can't imagine someone thinking this to be about the bride of Christ. We can ask Yeshua when we are with him. I'm not saying I believe this. This is the first time I've considered this idea. Because they are worthy. Does use of worthy evoke Luke 21:36? Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy. But you do have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments. They will walk with me in white. So in Luke 21:36 it says, and to stand before the Son of Man. What color does the bride wear? White. Back to the Book of Life. Like them, he who overcomes will be dressed in white, and I will never blot out his name from the Book of Life. But I will confess his name before my Father and his angels. So here is the point I was heading toward. By Jesus saying, I will never blot out his name from the Book of Life, the name has to already be in the Book of Life. Why make this statement if a person is once saved, always saved? Why say never? This makes allowance for others being blotted out after some time period shorter than forever. Think about this. The strict reading of this verse implies a name can be removed, blotted out from the Book of Life. The name has to already be in the Book of Life to be blotted out of the Book of Life. But don't get wigged out by this concept yet. Moving on. In Psalms, chapter 69 would be an interesting study, but I'm jumping into it for only a few verses. Psalm 69:25. May their camp be desolate, may none dwell in their tents. Clearly, David is praying bad things on these folks. For they have persecuted him whom you yourself have smitten, and they tell of the pain of those whom you have wounded. Isaiah 53:4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Might this be cursing those who persecuted and crucified Jesus? Add iniquity to their iniquity, and may they not come into your righteousness. May they be blotted out of the book of life, and may they not be recorded with the righteous. First, this does establish the book of life was known to the prophets of God, in this case, prophet David. So it was known within Judaism. But a curious prayer for prophet David to pray, because it presupposes they are in the book of life. God can remove handwriting that is there, like he did on the notes against us nailed to the cross. But logically, even God cannot blot out something that is not there. If you continue reading Psalm 69, the messianic tone does not abate. But I am afflicted and in pain. May your salvation, O God, set me securely on high. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. I will praise the name of God with song and magnify him with thanksgiving. And it will please the Lord better than an ox or a young bull with horns and hoofs. It will please the Lord? What will please the Lord? Whatever it is, it will please the Lord better than an ox or young bulls. Hebrews 10:3. Instead, those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Mention of oxen or bulls speaks of sacrifices, offerings to Jehovah God. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you took no delight." And it will please the Lord better than an ox or a young bull with horns and hoofs. God took no delight in the sacrifices of bulls and goats and other sin offerings. Then I said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God." Psalm 40:7. Then I said, "Here I am. I have come. It is written about me in the scroll. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart." In Luke 22:42, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." I have come to do your will, O God. In the passage above, he says, "Sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, nor did you delight in them, nor did you delight in them, although they are offered according to the law." Then he adds, "Here I am, I have come to do your will." He takes away the first to establish the second, and by that will, we have been sanctified through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once for all. This was the will of God. This pleased God. This donkey will get back to the book of life in the next video, if that is the direction the Spirit allows. Seems like an important topic if I catch the Lord's drift. In Luke 10:17, the 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." Pretty exciting stuff for demons to obey your commands. The concept is when commanded to get out of someone, not "Go get pizza," or "Give that witch a wedgie." So he told them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you." Again, this is really heady and exciting stuff. Nevertheless, that's cool and all, but pay attention. Don't focus on that. In spite of that, nevertheless, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you. Get over it. I'm about to tell you what's really important. But rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Can you say, Book of Life? May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And may your name be found in the Book of Life. Amen.